Good morning, everyone. Good morning. And welcome to SAMHSA's 26th annual Recovery Month observance. It's really an honor for me to be here this morning with all of you. My name is Tom Coderre, and I'm the Chief of Staff to the Administrator at SAMHSA. Recovery Month is so special to me because, as many of you know, I am a person in long-term recovery. And for me, that means I haven't used alcohol or drugs since May 15th of 2003, and my life has gotten better as a result, right? I've created a better life for myself, for my family, and ultimately my entire community, because that's what recovery gives us. It gives us that opportunity to create a better life for ourselves. It's not just about not using alcohol and other drugs. It's about creating that better life. And as a direct result of my recovery, I'm living a full and very productive life today. I'm proof that when people get the help that they need, they can and they do recover. I'm honored to serve as your MC for today's event, which highlights the important role recovery plays in addressing behavioral health issues, such as mental and substance use disorders. Recovery Month is the embodiment of SAMHSA's main message that behavioral health is essential to health, that prevention works, that treatment for mental and substance use disorders is effective, and that people can and do recover. It's a celebration of everyone who has achieved long-term recovery from mental and substance use disorders, and it recognizes contributions of dedicated people providing treatment and recovery services across our nation. This morning, we're going to hear from a wide array of speakers. They are people who are in recovery, people who are part of our government here in Washington, and people who are in recovery themselves and actively working to improve the behavioral health of our nation. To kick off today's event, I'm pleased to introduce SAMHSA's Acting Administrator, Kana Enomoto. Kana became Acting Administrator last month. Pam Hyde stepped down after nearly 6 years of dedicated service to the agency. Kana has been at SAMHSA for the last 17 years in a variety of roles, and is she's well-suited and prepared to lead SAMHSA into the future. So without further ado, our Acting Administrator, Kana Enomoto.
Thank you, Tom, and good morning, and welcome, everyone. I'm distracted by the commercials over there. It's like, those are not my slides. So as Tom mentioned, every year September is a very busy month for us at SAMHSA, as well as it being the Jewish holidays. It is also Recovery Month. It's also World Suicide Prevention Day and World Suicide Prevention Week. So it's also the time that we release the data which paint the picture of behavioral health for the nation. And we're very excited to present some of those reports for you today. The National Survey on Drug Use and Health is a snapshot in time of data collected from 68,000 Americans in a single year. So these are the data from 2014. I'm excited to be joined here today. I actually realize I'm the minority in many ways, the minority of women, but I think I'm also the minority in that last year we had the majority of people in recovery, and this year it's everybody but me. So it's actually amazing to see that these are not only people in recovery, but also people in power. And that is a great bellwether event for us in the behavioral health field. So thank you very much to our fabulous White House partner, Director Michael Botticelli from the Office of National Drug Control Policy. We're thrilled to have him today here. Tom Coderre, Chief of Staff, and Paolo Del Vecchio, Director of our Center for Mental Health Services, and old friend and new friend, Jonathan and Eduardo. You guys are going to hear not only the numbers, but the stories behind the numbers, and I think that's very exciting for us. Today, one of the reports we're releasing is Behavioral Health Trends in the United States, results from the 2014 National Survey on Drug Use and Health. It is the NISDA, as we so fondly call it, is the nation's primary source of statistical information on the use of illegal drugs, alcohol, and tobacco. The survey also covers mental health issues, so we have a full perspective of behavioral health. In the coming weeks and months, our Center for Behavioral Health Statistics and Quality and our Office of Communications are going to be very busy because we're going to issue a series of findings from the 2014 NISDA in separate data reviews. The data reviews are going to cover national trends in suicidal thoughts and behaviors among adults, substance use treatment, mental health service use, substance use prevention issues and initiation of substance use. So please be on the lookout for those important events. I want to thank Rear Admiral Peter Delaney, Ms. Janaki Bose, and the team from the Center for Behavioral Health Statistics and Quality for the outstanding leadership and technical expertise in overseeing this massive data collection and analysis. I'd like to thank our staff from the Centers for Mental Health Services, Center for Substance Use Treatment, and Office of Communications for pulling together this incredible event and so many of the events for Recovery Month. I want to thank our colleagues at NIH, CDC, and other federal partners who support this important effort. And of course, we would not be here today if it were not for the hundreds of field workers who collected almost 68,000, I was figuring that's like 200 interviews a day, face-to-face interviews last year. So that is, it's a huge undertaking to collect, aggregate, and analyze this type of national data. But when we boil it down and we synthesize it, the data tell a story about the health and well-being of Americans that far too few people know. The data speak to lives at risk. And how we respond as a nation, that matters more than ever before. Now I'm going to share with you a few highlights from our trend report, and I hope we will turn the numbers into stories. We'll turn those stories into actions, and we're going to turn those actions into meaningful change for those who are most vulnerable among us. First, I'll share... First, I'll share a few highlights, one more, with you regarding tobacco use, illicit drugs, and underage drinking. Let's start with tobacco. In 2014, an estimated 66.9 million people age 12 or older were current users of a tobacco product. So that's just over 25% of the adult population. That includes 55.2 million cigarette smokers, meaning that one out of five Americans over 12 is a current cigarette smoker. This number is far too high, but there is hope for the future. We're making steady, solid progress, especially with regard to adolescent use, which has been reduced by half over the past 10 years, from 13% in 2002 to only 5% in 2014. I think it would be great to see that number get to zero. Next slide. With regard to illicit drug use, we saw a small but significant increase in drug use among Americans 12 and older from 24.6 million in 2013 to 27 million in 2014. This means about 1 in 10 teens and adults in America have used illicit drugs in the past month. This increase appears to be driven primarily by an increase in marijuana use, which went from just under 20 million in 2013 to 22.2 million in 2014. The only significant increase we are seeing here is use among adults 26 and older. So the good news is that while young adults and adolescents are showing smaller variations, they were statistically similar to previous years, so not a significant increase. But as the marijuana use in adults slowly rises, we're seeing corresponding declines. So the use is rising, and then the decline in the number of individuals who perceive a great risk from smoking marijuana once a month or more. So there was almost 40% of Americans thought it was risky to smoke marijuana once a month in 2003. Now only 26.5% of Americans see that as a risky behavior. Among other illicit drugs, 2014 reflects a small but significant increase in the number of cocaine users from 1.3 to 1.5 million. And with regard to heroin, approximately 0.2% of the population, about 435,000 people, report current heroin use in 2014. The last decade has seen this number increase by 260%. So though heroin use reigns a smaller percentage than other illicit drugs, it is a highly addictive, dangerous drug, and such an increase is a significant public health concern. Additionally, an estimated 6.5 million Americans reported non-medical use of psychotherapeutic drugs or prescription medications in the past month. These drugs fall into four categories: pain medications, tranquilizers, stimulants, and sedatives. They cover numerous drugs which currently have or have been available by prescription, and they also include some drugs which are available by prescription but now are more likely to be manufactured and distributed illegally, such as methamphetamine. So in 2014, about two-thirds of those who said that they had non-medical use of psychotherapeutic drugs were doing the non-medical use of pain medication. So about 4.3 million people said they had non-medical use of pain medication in 2014. 1.6 million reported stimulant use, and of those, about a third were methamphetamine. So we've maintained reductions in abuse of pain medication among young people since 2012. That's a piece of good news. So 12 to 17-year-olds and 18 to 25-year-olds have had steady use, so no increases there. But we are seeing we've had reductions for those populations. But we're seeing steady use among those 26 and older. So reductions for young people and steady use among older 26 years old and above. The administration's urgent response to addressing opioid use disorders, and related overdose deaths will continue with increased efforts around prescription monitoring, medication-assisted treatment, and increased availability of naloxone to reverse the effects of overdose. Now we turn our attention to underage and binge drinking. Thank you. In 2014, 140 million Americans age 12 or older reported current use of alcohol. 60.9 million reported binge alcohol use in the past month, and 16.3 million reported heavy alcohol use. And in this case, binge drinking is five or more drinks in one occasion during the past month. Heavy drinking is five or more drinks on five or more occasions within 1 month. So that's heavy drinking. Though we have seen a small increase in past month alcohol use from 51 to 52.7%, overall rates of binge use have been fairly stable, and rates of heavy alcohol use have declined significantly from 6.7% in 2002 to 6.2% in 2014. The great news is that among youth aged 12 to 20, we've seen major declines from 2002 figures, with reductions in current use down from 28.8% in 2002 to 22.8% in 2014. Reductions in binge use have gone from about one in five youth now to one in seven youth. And declines in heavy use have reduced almost by half, from about 6% to 3%. So that's great news for our nation's young people. And I think it says a lot about our underage drinking prevention efforts. So as you've just heard, we've seen positive declines in alcohol, tobacco, and prescription drug use by teens. However, we may not stop to celebrate for too long. The concerning increases in adult marijuana, cocaine, and heroin use make it clear that the road to recovery is a long one, and there is much more work for us to do. So now I want to turn our attention to some of the key mental health findings for 2014. Like substance use disorders, mental disorders are serious health conditions characterized by changes in mood, thought, or behavior, which can have a devastating effect on family, school, work, health, and other important areas of social functioning. This morning, a few highlights here are about mental illness, major depressive episode, and suicide. Next. Nearly one in five adults age 18 or older had a mental illness in 2014. Good news for the baby boomers among us is that the percentage of adults with any mental illness in the past year was actually lower for those age 50 and older. It's a fairly steady finding across a number of the different dimensions. In a couple chuckles up here. Not depressed. In 2014, 9.8 million American adults, or about 4%, so 1 in 25, however, had a serious mental illness or a mental illness with serious impairment. And there's been an increase in the level of adults experienced past year SMI since 2009. This increase reflects a small but significant raise in the rate of SMI among adults 18 to 25, primarily. Using the diagnostic criteria of DSM-4, the NISDA also provides estimates of past year major depressive episode among adults and adolescents. In 2014, 6.6% of adults aged 18 or older, or about 15.7 million people, had at least one major depressive episode in the past year. And 4.3% of adults, 1 in 25, 10 million people, had major depressive episode with severe impairment. But for American teens, we see that more than 1 in 10, 12 to 17-year-olds, experienced a major depressive episode last year. 1 in 10 teenagers had a major depressive episode. These numbers have major implications for our next issue, which is suicide. It's important to note, as I did before, today's event coincides with World Suicide Prevention Day. We're happy to work with our partners at WHO, International Association for Suicide Prevention, and World Federation for Mental Health as we honor this day. Another report that we're issuing today focuses on suicidal thoughts and behavior among Americans. I'm going to go through a few of those findings, and Paolo Del Vecchio will go into greater detail about suicide's impact on our nation, families, and communities. In 2014, about one out of every 25 Americans thought seriously about trying to kill themselves. That's one person in every classroom, every office, every extended family. That's a handful or more in every sports league, in every house of worship, a college, or business. And it saddens me to report that more than a million people made a suicide attempt last year. That's more than a million of our brothers and sisters, our sons and daughters, our colleagues and our coworkers. And unfortunately, the rates for suicidal thoughts, suicide plans, and suicide attempts among adults have been stable for the past 6 to 7 years. There are certain groups that are at highest risk: young adults aged 18 to 25, women more often than men, and people with substance use disorders were much more likely to have made suicide plans or to have attempted suicide than people without substance use disorders. People with past year depression are especially likely to have serious thoughts of suicide, to have made plans or to have attempted. And just to illustrate this point, 4% of all adults had serious thoughts of suicide, compared with 30% of people with a major depressive episode. And here's some more troubling news. Among adults who had serious thoughts of suicide in the past year, nearly half did not receive any mental health services during that time. Suicide is preventable. We have evidence-based practices that have been shown to reduce the incidence of suicide, and we can prevent it. But we have to reach out and make the connection in order to give the science a chance. That's both for mental illnesses and substance use disorders. With so many Americans affected by behavioral health conditions, our goals must be shared goals. Our burdens are shared burdens, and our accomplishments will be collective. After all, the numbers I just shared are not just numbers. They translate to real people and to real lives. We have many powerful speakers here today who will share their stories to help us see that these lives, the faces and voices behind the data, are people who can achieve what my amazing colleagues here at the table have achieved. And with our continued support and collective efforts, prevention is possible and recovery can be a reality for anyone. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Acting Administrator Enomoto. You can see why I said she's well suited for this role that she's now in. Now it gives me a great pleasure to introduce our next speaker. Like myself, he too is in long-term recovery and an active force for recovery throughout the nation and one of SAMHSA's greatest allies. His nomination and confirmation were incredible moments of pride for our recovery community. Please welcome to the podium, for remarks, the Director for the White House Office of National Drug Control Policy, our recovery czar, Michael Botticelli.
Good morning, everybody. It's really a pleasure to be here. Tom, thank you for that introduction. And it's really a pleasure to share this journey in so many ways with you and people on this panel. I think I speak for everybody in recovery and those of us who love us and take care of us, that none of us would have expected our journey to lead us to this place and to this movement. And I'm really tremendously excited to be joined by our federal partners and many of you in this room who've been doing this work for so long. Those of us in recovery would never be here if it were not for the work that you do. Substance use disorders unfortunately affect people from all walks of life, but we know that prevention and treatment work and that recovery is indeed possible. The data released today shows signs of progress, including lower levels of non-medical prescription drug use and youth alcohol and tobacco use. These promising signs can be attributed to the tireless efforts of many people in this room and across the country. Evidence-based prevention efforts are the most effective way to reduce youth substance use and to support the roughly 90% of American youth who do not use drugs. However, we still have significant challenges to address. With the dramatic rise in heroin use and related overdoses, we know we are in the throes of one of the most pressing public health crises of our times. The President's FY16 budget proposes $133 million in new investments aimed at addressing the opioid overdose epidemic, including expanding evidence-based treatment programs and increasing access to the overdose reversal drug naloxone. Our office recently funded a network of public health and public safety law enforcement partnerships to address the heroin threat across 15 states. This kind of partnership between law enforcement and public health agencies is at the core of the Obama administration's approach, which addresses drug policy as both a public health and public safety issue. Recently, the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services recently announced $100 million in funding to community health centers to expand substance use disorder services with a focus on medication-assisted recovery for opioid use disorders. Disposing of prescription drugs in a convenient and environmentally responsible way continues to be important, as we know the majority of individuals who begin misusing prescription drugs obtain them from friends and family, often from their own home medicine cabinet. We are pleased that the Drug Enforcement Agency recently announced the 10th National Prescription Drug Take-Back Day for September 26. Individuals will be able to drop off unused or expired medications at local collection sites. Through these and other initiatives, this administration will continue to expand community-based efforts to prevent drug use, pursue smart-on-crime approaches to drug enforcement, work to reduce the supply of heroin, increase access to treatment, work to reduce overdose deaths, and chiefly to support the millions of Americans in recovery. Which brings us today as we celebrate the 26th National Recovery Month. I stand here today as one of the millions of Americans who are in recovery. Substance use disorders are a disease, and we are living proof that treatment works and that recovery is possible. Young people will continue to lead the way forward. That's why this year the White House is hosting Young People in Recovery for a special Recovery Month event, which will be live streamed from 7 to 8 p.m. on September 17th. How's that for a shameless promotion? Recovery groups across the country and others we hope will be watching and participating in the conversation. I hope you will join us in spreading the word. In the words of William White, recovery is contagious. That catching recovery often involves exposure to people in recovery. Those of us in recovery can be recovery carriers and infect others by our openness about our own recovery experiences. Recovery is truly infectious and magnetic, and together we can make profound changes simply by being honest and open about who we are. So thank you to all of you in this room for all that you do. We've made great progress, but we have much work to do. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Director Botticelli. I was just a quick question. Am I still considered young? Can I go to the September 17th?
It's a broad
age range. Oh, broad age range. All right, great. I'll be there then. Be there. Thank you. Next up is my colleague at SAMHSA, the director of SAMHSA's Center for Mental Health Services, Paolo Del Vecchio. Paolo and I have had the opportunity to work on many projects together over the last year, and I consider him a true colleague and friend, especially our work on the Recovery Support Strategic Initiative. So, Paolo, please.
Thank you, Tom, and good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you. For more than a quarter century, National Recovery Month has touched the lives of hundreds of thousands of American families with the powerful and hopeful message that recovery is real, recovery happens. Mental illnesses and addictions are treatable, and most overcome these issues to live full lives. I know because I am one of those individuals having lived with mental health and addiction conditions for most of my life. My disclosure is in keeping with this year's theme of Recovery Month, visible, valuable, and vocal, that in order to overcome the fear and shame associated with these conditions, we must stand up and speak out for the public to recognize that we are your family, friends, coworkers, and neighbors. SAMHSA, we define recovery as the process of how people take control of their illnesses, improve their behavioral health, and live their lives to the fullest potential. We know that recovery is built on access to evidence-based clinical treatment and recovery support services. We know how to support recovery. We know that treatment and services work, such as access to healthcare, stable and safe housing, a job, and social connections. But too often, sizable barrier continues to be for recovery the misperceptions and negative attitudes associated with mental illnesses and addictions. These attitudes lead to ongoing prejudice and discrimination that impacts educational opportunities, community life, and careers, and has a chilling effect on seeking care and treatment. As our First Lady, Michelle Obama, stated, we need to, quote, flip the script when it comes to mental health and addictions in this nation. SAMHSA, we're doing just that along with Recovery Month. SAMHSA supports such efforts as the Voice Awards, National Children's Mental Health Awareness Day, National Wellness Week, and the Campaign to Change Direction to help this vision become a reality and break down the barriers to recovery. We are co-sponsoring the Campaign to Change Direction with a Given Hour organization to help Americans recognize the five signs of emotional distress: personality change, agitation, withdrawal, poor self-care, and hopelessness. To identify these things in their friends and loved ones and tell them how to get help. And nothing could be more important to flip the script than to reverse the unacceptable tragedy of suicide in America and throughout the world. As noted earlier, today is the 13th observance of the World Suicide Prevention Day. We've worked very closely with the World Health Organization and contributed to their report on suicide entitled Preventing Suicide, a Global Imperative. Report encourages countries to prioritize suicide prevention and commit to the global target of the WHO Mental Health Action Plan to reduce the suicide rate in countries by 10% by 2020. The United States is an important partner in this effort. It's estimated that approximately 800,000 people die by suicide annually across the globe. In the U.S., more than twice as many people die by suicide than homicide, and more people die by suicide than from auto accidents. As the 10th leading cause of death in this country and the second among 15 to 34-year-olds, suicide is one of the most heartbreaking, pressing, and preventable public health challenges that we face. Here in America, we know that approximately 40,000 deaths by suicide occur every year. 40,000, the population of a small American city gone with little notice. Every suicide is a failure to reach someone when they're alive. The result is devastating for loved ones, friends, and colleagues. Since we know there will be about 40,000 suicides next year, that means there are 40,000 Americans alive right now that we can help. This is our opportunity, our call to action. If we want to end suicide, we must act now and reach out to support those particularly at risk. As Connor noted, the SAMHSA's NISDA survey findings released today note in particular the strong connection between substance use and suicide. Survey also revealed that young adults 18 to 25 in 2014 were more likely than adults in other age groups to have serious thoughts of suicides, to have made suicide plans, and to have attempted suicide. We also know, however, that most deaths due to suicide are among middle-aged males. SAMHSA is also a member and strong supporter of the National Action Alliance on Suicide Prevention, public-private efforts and leading efforts to reduce the impact of suicide in America by promoting implementation of the National Strategy for Suicide Prevention. We also support states, tribes, and campuses through our Garrett Lee Smith Youth and Campus Grant Programs, our Native Connections efforts to assist tribes, national strategy grants, all of which are designed to build community, human service, and healthcare systems to make preventing suicide a priority in communities across the nation. One of the most important SAMHSA prevention programs is the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline, 1-800-273-TALK, T-A-L-K. A national network of crisis centers that provide immediate life-saving help to people in emotional distress or suicide crisis. This year, Lifeline is on track to answer more than 1.5 million calls from individuals across the country. Today, I'm happy to announce the release of a new publication called A Journey to Health and Hope. Talk about shameless promotion. And this is a how-to guide to help people who've survived a suicide attempt take their first steps towards recovery and use their existence to inspire hope, safety, and connections with their peers and to share tools and resources. This free publication is available on our website at our SAMHSA store at SAMHSA.gov. Now, I'd like to introduce one of our nation's key behavioral health leaders, demonstrated outstanding leadership in promoting particularly the inclusion of attempted survivors, Eduardo Vega. Eduardo is executive director of the Mental Health Association of South of San Francisco, which is a nonprofit that works to improve the lives of San Francisco's diverse populations through advocacy, service, education, research, and to advance recovery-oriented care. I give you Eduardo Vega. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And can I just say how excited I am to be at this particular moment where I think we're seeing a huge wave of change. This month, we focus on the vision for recovery for all people impacted by mental health challenges. Many of these people hide in silence today and fear to disclose what they are experiencing because of fear of discrimination, rejection, and judgment. Nowhere have we seen this as more pronounced and problematic than when someone is facing a crisis in which they have thoughts and feelings of suicide. As someone who still lives in recovery with a mental illness and who survives suicide attempts, I hope that we can all work together to change this culture of fear and shame and to ensure that people feel supported rather than isolated at their toughest moments. Recovery is a journey that everyone makes their own, and it looks different for almost all of us as well. My struggles with anxiety and depression as a kid were mitigated by self-medication with street drugs. Yes, I used street drugs to help manage. That became a serious addiction. When I hit bottom with that after losing the support of family and friends, becoming unemployed and homeless, I thought the solution was suicide. Fortunately, rather than dying then, I was able to get treatment, confront my addiction, and eventually make my way back to school and to jobs. Later, even after being clean, however, and free from drugs for some time, I fell back into cycles of distress and despair. By this time, I had heard too many messages that told me, based on my condition, what was said about my condition at the time, that I had little to look forward to in life, that my dreams would never be realized, and that I'd be doomed to repeated destructive cycles and at best become a mental patient for life. I felt certain that it was more dignified to die by suicide than to face such a future. And I believed that if I told people I wanted to die, they would fear and reject me, be uncomfortable, or try to force me into the hands of law enforcement or other undignified treatment. The despair of that moment was amplified when, even after surviving that suicide attempt, I experienced rejection and prejudice. I was fired, suspended from college. I feared to involve my family, but even friends turned away from me as well. Shortly after this, I had an opportunity to work with people who were seriously disabled. Recognizing that I could make a difference in someone else's life was a thing that really changed me. It led me to find meaning for my own, enough purpose that I could face down the pain and distress of my condition, learn ways to cope, and make connections with others who could support me. My path is not the same as others, but we know that thousands of Americans suffer and attempt suicide each year. On the other hand, we also know that the vast majority of people recover lives of value for themselves and their communities. In order to stem this tide of suicide, as Kana has brought up, in order to make a difference for people who are facing their worst moments of distress, we must be able to listen supportively and without fear, without judgment, to people in their most difficult moments. We must, I think, create a more dignified and supportive set of solutions for people in crisis. And we must foster communities in which mental health and suicide prevention are seen as crucial, in which people have their dignity supported along with their health, and in which all of us who live in recovery are able to bring messages of hope and show ourselves, as we do in Recovery Month, as visible, vocal, and valuable. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Eduardo, for the beautiful description of what recovery is all about for you and for the work that you do around the country every day. In the next few minutes, I want to recap some of the vital efforts SAMHSA is supporting through its Center for Substance Abuse Treatment, or CSAT. I have had the privilege of working with the acting director, Daryl Cade, since Dr. Clark left last year, and it's been a completely eye-opening experience for me and something that I've really enjoyed immensely. And we hope to announce a new CSAT director soon, and hopefully that work will continue. CSAT's mission has been to help reduce the human and economic toll of substance use and misuse. For over two decades, CSAT has played a vital role in the successful treatment and sustained recovery of millions of Americans who are now living healthy and productive lives, supporting their families, building their communities, and contributing to the well-being of our country. Some examples of CSAT programs are early screening efforts, evidence-based treatment and recovery services, and prevention efforts that address a broad spectrum of substance use disorders. Through its programs, as well as block grants, CSAT has provided services to tens of millions of Americans. CSAT programs also specifically focus on minority, marginalized, unserved, and underserved populations. That is, individuals, families, and communities that fall into treatment and recovery gaps that still persist in our nation's healthcare delivery system. This can include pregnant and postpartum women, children, adolescents, and families, the homeless, people living in rural and tribal communities, racial, ethnic, and other minority populations, individuals with criminal justice involvement, and veterans, as well as military personnel. CSAT's mission also encompasses programs that address co-occurring conditions, including mental health disorders and infectious diseases such as HIV/AIDS and hepatitis. In this context, one of our congressional mandates is to promote the integration of substance use disorder treatment services into the mainstream of healthcare in the United States. To accomplish this mandate, CSAT and SAMHSA work in collaboration with numerous partners, including frontline healthcare providers and public partners, such as our friends at HRSA and CMS, to promote high-quality, evidence-based, integrated health services. One of our new FY 2016 proposals is for PCASI, a program for primary care and addiction services integration that will further advance and expand national healthcare integration efforts. CSAT closely monitors and continuously evaluates our federally, publicly funded, but locally provided healthcare services to address their effectiveness. The national outcome measures applied in these evaluations indicate that our programs are reducing substance use and misuse, are improving other health outcomes, including mental health outcomes, and increasing housing, employment, and education for people across this country, and are reducing criminal justice involvement, which is incredibly important. Yet even with this progress, CSAT remains keenly aware of how much we have yet to accomplish. There are still millions of Americans in need of treatment and recovery health services, and millions more we can help through prevention, education, and outreach. To meet the ongoing and evolving substance use health challenges our nation faces, CSAT will continue to administer and fund evidence-based treatment and recovery services, and we will continue to provide leadership and expertise to help inform local, state, and national policies. I want to specifically call out some of CSAT's ongoing efforts in the area of heroin and prescription drug misuse. This includes programs that are aligned with HHS Secretary Burwell's 2015 initiative to combat the prescription drug and heroin crisis facing our communities. As part of this HHS-wide effort, CSAT recently awarded $10.7 million in grants to 11 states that have experienced a high rate of primary treatment admissions for heroin and opioids that have seen a dramatic rise in admissions for these drugs in recent years. These new grants are designed to decrease illicit drug use and promote recovery by increasing the number of individuals receiving evidence-based treatment services such as FDA-approved medication-assisted therapies. And they're just one example of how CSAT supports and improves the recovery community in this nation. Lastly, before introducing our next guest, I just want to take this opportunity to republicize and reemphasize that SAMHSA provides free 24/7 health referral services for substance use and mental health issues. These resources are available by telephone or through the internet, and they will direct you to substance use and mental health services located right in your community. These resources include behavioral health treatment locators, a suicide prevention lifeline, and a disaster distress helpline. Please visit us online or call us to use these free and confidential public resources and to tap into many other resources and educational materials we have developed for the general public, for clinicians, for faith-based groups, for schools, for businesses, for policymakers, for insurance providers, for all of our stakeholders. Next, it's my pleasure to introduce our next recovery guest speaker, Jonathan Goyer, and to thank him for joining us here today to share with us his experiences and insights. Jonathan is Executive Director of Project Weber and an advisor on the Rhode Island Governor's Overdose Task Force. He also volunteers with Miriam Hospital's Preventing Overdose and Naloxone Intervention Program. Jonathan knows the challenges and barriers individuals in recovery face on a profound personal level. When I get tired, which I do frequently, or this road gets tough, his incredible story of loss, rebirth, and recovery motivate me to continue on a daily basis. Please welcome with me Jonathan Goyer.
Hello. Thank you, everyone, for having me here. 3 years ago, I wasn't even welcome at my mother's house, so it is a miracle for me to be here. I'm honored to be here and pleased to be given the opportunity to share my story during the national kickoff for Recovery Month. My name is Jonathan Goyer. I am 28 years old and I live in Providence, Rhode Island. I've experienced an addiction to opiates since the age of 14. In 2004, I lost my father to an overdose. And in 2009, my brother as well. Thanks to naloxone, my mother doesn't have to attend another funeral. A few years ago, my addiction led to my arrest. I served a few months in jail and was offered the opportunity to be released into a 90-day residential treatment center. Of course, I accepted this offer and I completed that program. I continued my journey by moving into a recovery house. 6 weeks later, I relapsed on heroin and overdosed. If it weren't for a few circumstances or coincidences, I wouldn't be alive today. I happened to leave my bedroom door ajar, and a resident happened to come home within minutes of my overdose. She ran downstairs to get the house manager, who happened to have naloxone in the house. Two doses were administered to me as I still unconsciously awaited for an ambulance to arrive. Something happened to me over the next few hours while I was lying in a hospital bed. I had a realization. A time to reflect, a moment that I would have never otherwise been afforded. There's a quote from 12-step literature that reads, either go on as best we can to the bitter ends, jails, institutions, or death, or find a new way to live. Having experienced the final of those three at that moment, I had to find a new way to live. Unfortunately, the disease of addiction is not that accommodating. And my mind naturally began racing to find a way to successfully get high again. Before those thoughts could develop into a plan, I had a few friends visit me in the hospital, friends I'd met in recovery. This was a support network of peers that had been where I was and wanted to help me for nothing in return but to see me succeed. They empowered me to make a few good choices when I left the hospital. Since that day, June 17th, 2013, I have not used drugs or alcohol and am a person in long-term recovery. Thank you. I have become excited about life again. Today, I work two jobs, one being as executive director of a nonprofit organization that provides prevention services to at-risk men on the streets. I have begun to pay off the financial debt I accrued during my active addiction, which was quite large, by the way. And I have become to be a good son to my mother. Aside from being excited about my new life in recovery, I have become passionate about preventing overdose deaths. In Rhode Island, I volunteer in our Department of Health's Overdose Prevention and Rescue Coalition, and also volunteer to distribute naloxone kits throughout the state. I've also recently been appointed to act as an advisor for our governor's Overdose Prevention Task Force, and pride myself on developing innovative strategies to address the overdose epidemic we face. Combating this epidemic is tough. We must stay on our feet and ahead of the game. However, at the end of the day, there will never be one big ultimate solution to this problem of addiction. It has to start with each individual here, with our own homes and families, with every interaction we have in our lives, with every human being we encounter. There are more people suffering from addiction just as I was, and it's up to us to be there for them. It's up to us to love those who don't yet love themselves. Do you know why it is so crucial to love the homeless man outside of a liquor store, or the woman that was recently released from prison? Because if we help them down the road, those are the people that will be in recovery and help you or your loved one if they ever find themselves down the road of addiction. It could be those people that offer a warm, welcoming hug to your friend, neighbor, or coworker at their first 12-step meeting. It may even be those people that become recovery coaches and help your son or daughter, niece or nephew to find and sustain recovery. We can't pick and choose who will find recovery and when, but we can pick and choose who we are willing to extend help to. We need to help those people today so that they can help more people tomorrow and so forth. As my story illustrates, we are all connected. In the last few years, I've not only learned that recovery is possible, but I've experienced that recovery is a reality. And where there is breath, there is hope. Hope that any individual can find recovery and become a responsible, productive, and contributing member of society. I stand before you today as an example of that. Thank you.
Great job, Jonathan. Thank you for being willing to put yourself before this august body in this at the National Press Club and tell that inspiring story. Let's thank all of our speakers once more today. Weren't they great? The acting administrator pointed out that this was a real important moment in our community, in the recovery community, having people in recovery take these positions of leadership. And I know there are two people who are looking down today on us, Jimmy Gillen and Jerry Gillen, who would have been very, very proud of this press conference today and this moment. So in their honor, I just want to take a moment of silence to recognize them. Thank you. I also want to acknowledge the director of SAMHSA's Center for Behavioral Health and Statistical Quality. I'm sorry, Pete. CBISC, also known as CBISC, which is much easier to say, Rear Admiral Pete Delaney, who oversees the administration of SAMHSA's National Survey on Drug Use and Health. He and his team at CBISC provide national leadership in behavioral health statistics and epidemiology and are responsible for the development of the NHSDA report that we're releasing today. They have done a tremendous job, as they do every year, compiling and putting together this data. So, Pete, take a bow, please. Thank you. And since everyone else who got up here today made a shameless plug, I'm going to take one opportunity to do it. When they give you the microphone, you have that one opportunity. And that's to invite everyone to join us on the National Mall on October 4th, when the recovery community will come together with family, friends, and allies to unite to face addiction. It's going to be a spectacular event, and I hope you all can be there with us. So before we take a few questions, I would like to ask you to observe just a few ground rules. In the interest of time, we're going to be taking questions from the media first. Please limit yourself to one question, use available microphones, state your name and affiliation, and please indicate who you want to respond to your question. So are there any questions from the press that are in the room?
Okay, now. Can I fill some time?
No, now we'll open it up to any questions from anybody else in the audience. Yes, Dr. Oz. Welcome.
Please, both mics. I must say, I did not expect this event. I want to applaud SAMHSA, not just for the data, which I'd seen this morning, but having folks tell the story so beautifully. As you know, we're engaging in this process, trying to support that October 4th march. I'd love to know how many, maybe kind of you can start, how many of the folks that we know are having issues with addiction are actually seeking help?
Know is that about of the 22 million, 21.5 million people that have a substance use disorder, about 4 million get any help at all. And of those 4 million, about 1.5 million are in a self-help group. So only about 10% of the people who have a substance use disorder are getting treatment in a specialty facility. That means 90% of people who meet criteria for needing treatment for substance use disorder don't get any treatment at all.
So it's sort of stunning. I mean, Mike's coming on the show, so I can pester you on this on the show. Maybe I'll save your powder for anybody. Why is that? What excuses did they give? I don't know if you're able to ask those questions in these 60-plus thousand people you've spoken to.
Sure.
Tom or anybody or Mike?
So I think that, you know, when you look at the predominant, and actually the national survey really does a good job at kind of quantifying this information. So we know the vast majority of people who meet diagnostic criteria do not get care, do not know they have a problem. And I think it's actually a failure of our system to diagnose people with medical disorders. And we often put the locus of responsibility of people with addiction on their own self to identify the disease. You know, we often talk about the phenomena that people have to hit bottom before they seek care. Well, we don't do that with any other disorder. We do early intervention. We do diagnosis throughout the medical establishment. We also know, however, that there are significant barriers for people who want to seek care. Those include shame and stigma, that people who know they have a disorder are often fear what their neighbors, what their employers will think. That's why events such as this, Recovery Month, become really important to destigmatize. But the other piece is that we often know people lack access to insurance coverage or insurance coverage that promote substance use disorder and behavioral health treatment. That's why the Affordable Care Act becomes incredibly important in that it says that substance use disorder and mental health services must be part of a benefit package offered under the healthcare expansion markets. So it really becomes important for us to really look at getting people adequate coverage and also ensuring that that coverage be offered on par with other medical conditions. So part of what we try to do as federal agencies is address all of the factors that go into why people are not getting care.
We have a question on this side.
And before we go to the question, just wanted to thank Dr. Oz. We recently learned that you're going to be doing an entire series this fall to help Americans who may be thinking that they might have a substance use or mental disorder to seek the help that they need. So thank you very much for doing that. Yes.
This question is for Jonathan. Jonathan, yesterday a press release came across my desk about someone wanting to stop the use of naloxone, especially for individuals who they've had to use it more than once for them. Could you respond to that, and what would be your advocacy efforts to try to prevent something like that from happening, or would you?
Sure, so I hear a lot of people, a theory out there that people say, does naloxone enable people to use more, so to speak, and somebody had asked me that, and they said, so would you use twice as much knowing that there's naloxone available? I said, no, I need that other half for later. I'm not gonna do it all now. Thank you, Tom. So my response is my own personal story, and as I had said in my speech, for me, it was a point of intervention that it afforded me that I would have never otherwise been afforded. And that's what I know, and that's what my story speaks to. So I'm going to continue to share that story. Thank you.
And many of our programs, we've given guidance to many of our grantees that they can use their grant dollars, especially block grant dollars, to fund the purchase and distribution of naloxone, that life-saving drug. Thank you. Question over here, Robert.
Yeah, Robert Ashford, Program Director for Young People in Recovery. Thanks for y'all that have shared your personal stories, whether as in leadership or as individuals with experience and not in leadership. Thank you. Question really is for anybody, and maybe more on the administration side, but what is essentially a 100% increase in heroin use, even if it could be argued that it's negligible from point one to point two, if we saw a 100% increase in any other illicit substance or legal substance, the entire, whether it's Capitol Hill, the administration, HRSA, HHS, would be up in arms. And I realize that we're attacking this from multiple fronts, whether it's through grassroots advocacy, true programming, new funding streams, the high impact money that just came out was wonderful. Thank you, Director. But why isn't Capitol Hill up in arms? And if we, again, 100% increase is something that I don't think we've ever seen in anything ever before in NISTA data, I mean, that's huge.
So I'll start and folks can, part of what I think is really important is knowing that the continued explosion of heroin use is driven by a prescription drug use issue. We know that 4/5 of newer heroin users actually started by misusing prescription pain medication. And we actually know many of them, actually, when we're talking about primary prevention, often started with alcohol, tobacco, and marijuana from a very young age when you listen to people's story. So, you know, since 2011, we've been engaged in a plan to reduce prescription drug use and now heroin use, quite honestly. But, you know, and I say this quite candidly, while we've made many progress, I don't think we've really reduced the overprescribing of prescription pain medication in the United States. And, you know, I think many folks have stepped to the table in terms of really reducing this. I think we see good data about the decline in the misuse of prescription pain medication. But we also need to have systemic approaches. And I think that's why this administration particularly has stepped forward with a number of new both policy and funding initiatives to help deal not only with the prescription drug use issue, but the heroin issue. I will say there's been, you know, a significant amount of legislation that's been introduced in Congress to focus on this issue, and many dealing with those issues. So we hope that this session we can see the passage of some legislation that will actually make a difference in this epidemic.
One second. The acting minister.
Yeah, and next week, Secretary Burwell is pleased to be inviting all the states for a 50-state summit. 50-state summit
meeting. Being referred to
on because it's a tongue twister, but a 50-state meeting on opioid use and prevention. So I think this is an issue that we know we hear quite a bit from the Hill about it, and the administration is taking it very seriously from the White House down.
And there are many proposals in Congress as well to address this epidemic that we're seeing. There are a lot of champions on the Hill who are fighting hard, but we know what the climate is there right now in terms of getting things passed. So I think they're going to continue to work diligently through the fall session. They just came back into session, and I think we're going to see a lot more activity on that front this fall. Yes, Joe.
My name is Joe Powell. I'm a person in long-term recovery. Hey, Mike. I am also the president of the Association of Persons Affected by Addiction in Dallas. My question is, since we're talking about spread and recovery, that in the results from the 2014 National Survey on Drug Use and Health, I'd like to know how soon before we get the recovery results. I mean, we know that William White says, of course, that recovery is contagious. How can we show the communities, the diverse communities, are really getting the help that they need in recovery?
It's a great question, Joe. Do you want to take that? Do you want to talk about the recovery module that's coming soon? Measure, I'm sorry.
Do I have to do a shameless promotion now?
Please.
So it is a really good question.
I didn't ask him to ask that either, Pete, I promise.
Yeah, I'll talk to you later. So what we have, what we've been working on with our colleagues at IOM and our colleagues at NIDA and at CDC is the development of a recovery module. And I have to actually hand off a hats off to Paulo because he's been pushing me shamelessly to get this done. And we've run a new test with a couple of measures, but we should have a measure out that we're going to start putting into practice in the next redesign, because as we get a subsequent redesign, we put it in there. So we'll actually be able to track people in recovery. That's my best thing. Ever since I started at NIDA, I always wanted to study people who were doing well, and now we're going to do it. So give me a couple of years, we'll have some data for you.
Okay, that's all the time we have for questions. This concludes today's event. I want to thank, again, everyone who participated, including our speakers, you, the fabulous audience we have here today, and all those people who make this event possible. National Recovery Month promotes the societal benefits of prevention, treatment, and recovery for mental and substance use disorders. We hope that through this and other events, we can continue to raise public awareness throughout all segments of our nation's communities that people with mental and substance use disorders can and do recover and lead happy and fulfilling lives. Thank you for being here.